evening and welcome to this edition of Scientific Evenings of the University of Nova Gorica. We'll speak about energy tonight, in particular about alternative sources of energy. We all know that silicon solar cells are one of the most important sources of for harvesting solar energy. But they suffer from relatively high price, high energy invested for their production, and in particular they are burdened with large quantities of potentially environmentally hazardous materials. Therefore, we witnessed in late 70s and early 80s a surge in interest, especially in the scientific community dealing with material science and physics, for new ways to harvest solar energy. And I would like to point out that in 1991 an article appeared in Nature magazine entitled "A Low-Cost, High-Efficiency Solar Cell Based on Dye-Sensitized Colloidal Titanium Dioxide Films." The authors were Brian O'Regan and Michael Gretzel. And with that paper, we can easily say that the new era in photovoltaic technology was born. And we are extremely honored that we can host Professor Michael Gretzel today and hear from him about the exciting story of Gretzel cells, as they are called. But before I leave the podium to Professor Gretzel, let me spend a few words about his career. He's a professor at École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne, where he also heads the Laboratory of Photonics and Interfaces. He pioneered research on energy and electron transfer reactions in mesoscopic materials and their applications in solar energy conversion systems, optoelectronic devices, and lithium-ion batteries. He's the author of over 800 peer-reviewed publications. He wrote two books, and he owns patents, more than 50 patents. His work has obtained more than 60,000 citations. For those of you who follow this, thinks his hey, H index is 114. This ranks him amongst the 10 most highly cited chemists worldwide. He has received prestigious awards, including the, if we start with the recent award, 2010 year Millennium Technology Prize, which is technology equivalent of Nobel Prize, the City of Florence Award, the Balzan Prize, Galvani Medal, Faraday Medal, Harvey Prize, Greischer Award, Dutch Havenga Award and Medal, International Prize of the Japanese Society of Coordination Chemistry, ENI Italgas Energy Prize, the year 2000 European Grand Prix of Innovation, to name just a few. Scientific American magazine selected him as one of the top 50 researchers in the world. Professor Gretzel received a doctoral degree from the Technical University of Berlin, and he also holds honorary doctoral degrees from the universities of Hasselt, Delft, Uppsala, and Turin. He has been the Mary Upton Visiting Professor at Cornell University, Visiting Professor at the National University of Singapore, Invited Professor at the University of Berkeley, École Nationale de Cachan, and Delft University of Technology. In 2009, Professor Gretzel was named Distinguished Honorary Professor by the Chinese Academy of Science and the Huazhong University of Science and Technology. He's a member of Swiss Chemical Society and the European Academy of Science, and a fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry, and was elected honorary member of the Société Vaudoise de Sciences Naturelles. So I'm sure that you all agree that we are again very honored to have this such an honored guest, and Professor Gretzel, please
Well, good evening. It's really embarrassing to hear all these kind remarks, and thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm just a humble researcher, and I'd like to also thank all the distinguished guests tonight attend this lecture. So it's getting later than we planned. So if there was some travel issues, I have to teach today, and so I'm arriving just from Switzerland now. And so, yes, also I should mention that it's a great honor tomorrow to assist in the 15th anniversary celebrations of Nova Gorica University, and I think I'm not saying a secret, I'm announcing that there will be a very big event for me to attend this lecture, this celebration. So, tonight we will be talking about the solar cells, which has been a passion for us for quite a while. In research, you have to be passionate. Research is a curiosity-driven affair, but somebody who doesn't have the passion, he will never succeed. And so gift to observation, curiosity, and passion. And so my passion has been with photoconversion and storage. And so tonight, first I'd like to acknowledge, I'm heading a pretty big group. We are about 50 people. And the work I'm presenting is mainly that of my coworkers. And so I'm very indebted to my group for contribution. I will mention some of the specific contributions. Otherwise, I would just spend an hour saying what everybody did on this slide. And so I should also mention that we are very grateful especially for the Swiss, and we have American funding, and we have European funding. That's the most important for us, the FP7 programs. If we wouldn't have those, and I have an ERC grant, advanced research grant, we would really be in trouble with our research. So very grateful to the EU. And the first one to emphasize that. I also have some money from KAUST, the King Abdullah University of Science and Technology. And we are part of the Stanford Center for Advanced Molecular Photovoltaics. So this is a group of professors that mainly at Stanford, but we are one of the foreigners, one of the principal investigators. And also, I'd like to thank the Finnish people for their generosity in creating this technology award. And this prize is actually carried by sponsors and by the people, by taxpayers. And so one should be always very grateful for the taxpayer that supports. And so this has also been a very important prize, in as much as it not only lifted our profile as a research institution, but it's also cash that can be used in the research. And so buy equipment. One never has enough money when you do research. So, the problem we are facing today is that the energy demand is growing. I mean, this number here is in exajoules. Today, the world is consuming per year about 400 exajoules. That's 400 times 10 to the power of 18. So that makes 4 times 10 to the power of 20. That's today's energy consumption. People saying, well, even if we are cutting back and all sorts of conservation measures, which of course we have to do, it still will be doubling by year 2050. We'll be up at 800 exajoules. And so And so the problem is that this comes at a time when there's a global warming and the oil is being consumed. 1 trillion barrels have been burned in a very short time. And that's not going to stop. A couple of weeks ago, I was in China and at Tianjin, the Economic Forum, and I was told that every other week the Chinese build a 1 gigawatt coal-fired power plant. So, and you can see those trucks, just coal coming from Australia being burned in those. So there's a huge problem with the increased demand. This curve grows because of the developing countries. It's not that we are using more energy. Actually, this curve counts on the developing countries going down energy. There are more people in the world. The world population will grow from 6 to 9 billion probably in the next 40 years. And then there is this emerging economies. These countries need more energy, a very low consumption rate. And so the other thing is the pollution, and this looks terrible. It's just the picture is not that dark, but it's just some kind of artifact with the projector. But it's terrible. If you spend time, I was in Tianjin, it's a major city, the third biggest city in China, not far from Beijing. It's just awful, the pollution. So we have to do so. So there is a bad scenario here. We need more energy, but we can't burn the coal or fossil because of the warming and pollution, and the oil is anyway dropping. So of course the solution could be an alternative. Solar is sufficient. If you look at today's power consumption, if you calculate 400 exajoules per year, if you translate that into a power, that would be about 14 terawatts. And that's our power consumption. And so the sun is 120,000 terawatts. It's a huge difference. And although not all this solar radiation can be used, people say 600 terawatts is easily accessible. And so it will grow by a factor of 2. So we've gone from 14 to 28, and so there are 600 out there. So it's a difficult proposition because there have been setbacks and lots of talking about using solar. And today, if we ask ourselves how much does solar contribute, and it's actually very small, the photovoltaic part, there is biomass. That's not so small. And so one has to use everything, biomass, wind, or hydroelectric. So these are some of the options. And the challenge is to have a carbon-free source. So this summarizes the situation I just described to you, so I won't dwell very long on that slide. And the cost is an issue, and one needs to have resources that are plentiful and cheap. And so this, some people think actually this is an intractable problem, okay? And that we need a miracle to happen. But of course, that's not the way to think about it. And so let's look at some hard figures. So if you want to use carbon neutral energy sources, so here's a list. I won't go through all these figures. This is just to give you a rough idea. So if you think about wind, that's 2 terawatts. Just think about the gap, 14 terawatts to be covered by year 2050, that's the gap. The total will be 28. So So if we just said, well, the gap has to be covered by renewables, well, then here's the list, or carbon free, then you come up with these numbers, and well, you know, if we put everything together, then here we mentioned solar, but biomass also solar, of course. This is more specifically photovoltaic or photothermal energy conversion. It's also another very, what should I say, very promising for research domain, which is the direct photoconversion of solar energy to hydrogen by water splitting. And actually, that's how I started when I was a young scientist. I thought we need to use sunlight to split water into hydrogen oxygen. But this turns out to be a very, very tough problem. Now, with the new advanced material science, we can tackle this problem much more readily than in the early days when we were somewhat naive what it would take, you know, to solve the issues. And so I just wanted to show you a quote from Thomas Edison, who's the inventor of the light bulb. That dates from 1931. And he says, I have put my money on the sun and solar energy. That's what I did as well. So I followed his advice. What a source of power. I hope we don't have to wait until oil and coal run out before we tackle that. Okay? So, and here is some German analysis on this is a German advisory council on global change. So it's appointed by the federal cabinet in Germany, and so they have come up with these numbers. And so if you think about 2050, well, you see there's still going to be coal, but it's coming down. The fossils are coming down. Looks like the fossils peak just around now, and then they come down. And the extra power needed to get up to those exajoules I mentioned to you is the doubling. Well, we need to, this part here. These are the renewables, and a lot of it is solar power by photovoltaics and solar thermal. And so you might have heard about this Desert Tech. Have you heard about Desert Tech? This project is something that has to do with creating power in the Sahara Desert. And that would be from thermal concentrators. And so there's no silver bullet. I think you know what that means, a silver bullet. A silver bullet kills all the problems, but there is no silver bullet. So we need to use all the possible resources. The challenge is enormous. And especially the young people have to be alerted to go into technology and natural science. In Switzerland for a while, our youngsters would go all into banking. Even some PhD students would become bankers afterwards. Just the money, the easy money. But then, you know, what happened 2 years ago, the banks got clobbered. Because it's not enough to do virtual creation of fortunes. You have to work and have real values behind whatever financial value you put on a product. And so, we have I mentioned the solar fuel production. It's something that a lot of people don't even think about. But I would like to mention to you that the Obama government just has given a $110 million grant to Caltech to work on the direct generation of fuel from sunlight. And what that means is going back to the water splitting, so that hydrogen from water, but then you might as well use the hydrogen to reduce CO2 to methanol or formic acid or some kind of a storage, stored energy product like photosynthesis. That's photosynthesis comes up with a solution Well, sunlight and CO2 is converted into sugar and oxygen. And so that's the goal. I think very nice, because one of the problems of photovoltaics is a storage issue. And that's a very general issue with solar energy conversion. And so I was in Sweden just some few weeks ago, and on a panel in the Swedish said, solar is not for us because we have no sun in the winter. And so, well, that's true. So we need to work on storage systems as well. And so if we now go to the solar cells, we have some criteria, the efficiency, stability, and we have the price, of course. You have to come up with a system that provides 1 kilowatt hour for 5 cents. Otherwise, like wind power would be cheaper and nuclear power would be cheaper. So one has to be very honest about the price levels we need to achieve. So today, this is not the case. If we take silicon solar panels, about 6 times higher or even 10 times higher, depends where you put your panels. If you put them in the Sahara, the electricity is cheaper because there's more sunlight during 1 year, and so you can amortize your system more quickly. But in Switzerland, we have 3 times less in the Sahara, so the price is an issue. As industrial upscaling, these are all evident. Resource feedback, feedstock recyclability. Energy payback time is also very important. How long does it take to get the energy back you have put into your panels? And that depends also where you put your panels up. And so if the best case scenario is you put the panel in a desert, and so that will, in silicon, you got about 2 years. It's too long, really, because the growth is so strong that you need energy to fuel the growth. And so the payback time is not short enough, so that as a result, all this business actually consuming more energy than it produces. And so you need to have less than a year of payback time to fuel that growth of 40% or 30%. And that's this shown here. We had in the photovoltaics, we have had a growth of huge growth. There was a problem in 2008 with the Spanish government cutting back on their subsidies. And then I don't know whether you own shares in PV companies. The value plummeted. Investors got extremely angry, turned off. This is still today a problem. The investors will not forget that they lost money. And I some other people, myself, we had some investment in silicon-based companies. They all got clobbered because just that small thing in Spain that tipped the whole situation. And the Chinese came in with cheap modules, so that wiped out almost the whole competition here in Europe. So one has to be careful when you talk about subsidized technologies, and at the end you have to be able to compete without government subsidies, because the government cannot afford it. The bigger the market becomes, the more subsidies will be required. And today in Germany, already we're cutting back on subsidies. It becomes too big a burden for the government or the folks that buy electric power from the power companies. And so really, you want to be down, I mentioned that, to about in the 5, if you have euros per kilowatt hour, well, you want to be down at 5 euro cents per kilowatt hour. Now, is that achieved today? No, it's not. Not by the silicon photovoltaic cells. So here's this cell which we developed as use a different principle. It's a It's the only solar cell that mimics photosynthesis, because it uses a molecule to absorb light, like chlorophyll in the green leaf. And that molecule is generating electric charges after light absorption. So the light energizes the molecule, and the molecule generates electric charges. Exactly what happens in the green leaf when it's exposed to sunlight. Of course, you don't see these electric charges. Some people may not even know that there are electric charges produced. And they would question that and say, why don't we put a wire in a green leaf and get this current out then? Well, the thing with a green leaf is that the charges are consumed on a very small scale. They go across the membrane, 50 angstroms, and they are used up in redox reactions that produce the sugar at the end and oxygen from water. And so the plant converts immediately those charges into chemicals, fuels. But our cell, when I was starting this research, the situation was desperate, because that was in 84 when the oil price was $4 per barrel. Now the oil is trading at 85. Well, there's inflation, but still, I mean, it's a huge difference. In those days, no interest at all for photovoltaics. And so I thought, well, unless we can come up with a system that is cheap and efficient and stable, then there's no chance we can get recognition, or one will not take us seriously. That's the simple equation. And so the Dyson cell was, we deliberately went into power production because it's easier. You can measure the electricity, you can control how stable these things are. So you can check very quickly whether this system satisfies the low cost and stability requirements of a practical photovoltaic cell. And so you can see today we have this, next week I'm going to a conference in Japan, and this is on future photovoltaics. And you can see that the Dyson size technology is mentioned here as being a forerunner in the low-cost field. And indeed, the Japanese companies have done the evaluation and shown that the Dyson-sized mesoscopic solar cells, you can get to 5 cents per kilowatt hour. It's not a huge conjecture. It just takes some development, scale up. And so that's how we start. We started in the 80s just working on fundamental research. We were curiosity-driven. We were the first to make those colloidal quantum dots, are they called today, but we called them colloidal particles in those days. And we found that we could sensitize those colloidal particles very efficiently. That these were all fundamental studies carried out with a laser in the laboratory, and we could see that the electrons would go very quickly from the sensitized into the pigment particle, nanometer-sized pigment particle. And it would come out much more slowly, 9 orders of magnitude difference in the charge separation. Forward reaction was very fast. We couldn't even measure it in those days. Today, we know that these forward reactions occur in the femtosecond range. You need a femtosecond laser to measure those. In those days, I had only a nanosecond laser. I couldn't measure it. But we could see that the injection occurred on a nanosecond time scale immediately. This was immediate on that scale. And then the back reaction was much more slowly. So we had a very good charge separation on those nanoparticles. And that was the driving force to build first cell that looked very mundane. It's just a beaker with the two electrodes. Then the Nature publication, which used already the nanoparticulate film. And today we have modules. We have production started now in Wales. The first 120 megawatt plant was built in Wales, in Cardiff, Wales. And the products of flexible cells. In beginning of September, the 9th of September, the German president, Christian Wolff, visited us. And our president, Doris Leuthard, is our decisions president. He was on a state visit to Switzerland. So she said, well, we should look at the EPFL in Lausanne and look perhaps on Professor Gretzel's experiment there. And so they asked me to set up an experiment, which we did. And we also gave the two presidents a backpack. The one for the Swiss with a red cross, very easy to make this into a red, a white on white cross on red. And the German president with the German colors. So this bag is one of the first products in the Moskovic solar cell. It's made in Hong Kong by Mascot, Chinese producer, but the cells are from Wales, the European-made cells. And you can buy it on the internet. My sister has bought one, and as I said, we gave one to the German president, and he enjoyed it. You can use that electric power to charge up your phone or lamp. There's a battery in there. You can use the power for whatever need you have. But we also have now the building integrated photovoltaics. And it's a little bit dark, but these are the panels here, hard to see. So I just explained to you one more time. In the Dyson cell, we have the sensitizer, we have these nanoparticles, which are applied as a paste on a screen printed, and we have electrolyte. Usually this is actually an ionic liquid. It's a molten salt. This is not an electrolyte that has a vapor pressure. That's very important because you don't want to have things that can evaporate or things that can flow out of the device. So we moved into ionic liquids. We were the first to apply a patent for the use of ionic liquids. We developed those ionic liquids. Some were already known, but nobody had thought about using those in energy conversion devices at that time. Now it's a different story. And so this compound is called propyl methyl imidazolium iodide. That's a liquid at room temperature. It's a salt, but it's a liquid down to minus 80 degrees. And that's what we use as a redox system to shuttle the positive charge from the dye to the back contact. And so the first dyes had this ruthenium structure, but see the absorption spectrum here. So they cover pretty much up to the red region. This is the absorption, this is the solar spectrum here. So do they take a lot out of the solar spectrum? Doesn't look like it, but in any event, anything above 900, it's useless. You don't want to take it for PV, unless you build a tandem cell where you have two absorber layers. The optimum threshold for a single junction PV is about 900. You see also, if you start collecting between 9 and 1,000, actually there's a dip here. The water absorbs at the atmosphere. There's not many photons coming in the first place at this wavelength region. There are more in the infrared, but they have too small energy, so the photovoltaic cell that uses those photons will have a very low voltage. And so there's optimum high current, low voltage, but there's an optimum here for the power production, so about 900. Our cells, these dyes didn't absorb a whole lot beyond 800. And so we still, today we have much better dyes. I'll show you in a minute. So dye gets excited, that's number one. And then it can inject the charge because it has more energy in the excited state than the ground state. So that's this event number two. The TiO2 is a anodyne pigment. You sit there in toothpaste, it's on the white paint on walls is TiO2, it's titanium dioxide. You wouldn't think this to be a semiconductor, okay, but it is. It's a wide bandgap semiconductor. And so we are not using the valence band, we just use a conduction band as a like a wire to get the electrons out of the system. So we inject into those small nanoparticles, and so they are the electrons moving out. That's number three. And then the electrons move out and they do the work, and they now we have lost an electron, so we charge the sensors positively. So we need a shuttle to bring these electrons back. That's the iodide, triiodide shuttle. We have new redox systems. So that's a cycle. And so nothing else happens in a conversion of sunlight to electric power. And the nanocrystals are very important. If you use a flat layer of the same material, TiO2, very few photons will be converted to electrons. Less than 0.2% of the incident flux. So that was the state of the art when we, as a young person, I like to also give you that as an advice to young people. When we started on this, to work on this system, the prevailing opinion was it doesn't work. Forget it. You're wasting your time. So we started working on sensitizers. Say, oh, you can't, because simply the light, if you have a monolayer of sensitizer, the light goes right through. It's not absorbed. The interaction of that monolayer with the light is too weak. And people know you need about 200 layers to get the light absorbed, but then the outer layer is a filter. So it's just not something that would be working. And so it was very surprising that in this, with the nanoparticles, of course, now you solve that this light will hit many dye layers. You see, each nanoparticle has a dye layer on. But there, the opinion was, it's too disordered. This is so messy, this system. You never get your charges out. And that was wrong. So we showed that, indeed, if you inject an electron in a particle, you can collect, you can control the recombination. That's our earlier laser experiment showed that. So kinetic control can make it much longer. These charges live for 1 second. Why? Well, because one charge is moving in the particles and the other is moving in the pores. And so they are separated by an interface. In silicon, both charges move in the same medium. So the recombination time, even if you take 99.999969 grade solar grade silicon, the electron hole lifetime is a few microseconds. Here, with that trick to separate one charge moves in one phase and the other in the other phase, you gain a factor of 1,000,000 in charge carrier lifetime. And that makes it possible to collect those carriers. And so the trick is to separate the light absorption from carrier transport. That's the first system that achieves that. And that relaxes constraints on individual components. So I can use any dye I want, green, blue, red. Of course, it has to be active. It has to inject, it has to be stable, and so on. But if you use a semiconductor like silicon, well, you have to use silicon. That's it. That's one material that you're fixed. Also, in the silicon, you have this accumulation of tasks. The silicon absorbs carriers and has to transport, absorbs the light, generates carriers from light. These are the negative and positive charges. But then they also have to be conducted, right, transported by the same material. So there's accumulation of functions here. That's why we need 99.999969 type solar grade silicon. Otherwise, it wouldn't work. But here I separate. So the trick is really go to the mesoscopic dimension, and you get the best of the two worlds. That was shown, and as I said, it's very similar to the principle of photosynthesis. I don't want to go into details now. I just show you now some applications, because the time is, For many years, we were stuck with a lack of rate response. You can see this blue curve is the standard die. It absorbs, what we are plotting here is the efficiency of charge carrier generation from the incident photons. So if that number is, I don't know whether you can read this, this number is 90, that means the photons that are green in the 5 to 600 nanometer range, the green photons that strike the cell, they will be converted to electric current, measurable electric current with 90% efficiency. So it's incident photon flux and electrons out. Electric current out divided by incident photon flux. And so you see we can, for a while we were really stuck on with this response, and I had a graduate student of mine, Oliver Cole, he's a particularly stubborn person. He wrote a thesis why that was the end of the story and we would never get any better. And so he had developed his own theory about why we would get, the response could never be better. But as you can see, this was totally wrong. And I told him at that, I said, Oliver, in science, you never want to say dogmatic things because there's no room for dogmas. There's room for creativity and new inventions. And not soon after, we came up with this black dye that has a green curve, so it's already better. But recently, the Japanese Dr. Segawa from the University of Tokyo, he comes up with this wonderful sensitizer. It goes up to 1,000 nanometer. Well, if you look at this response curve, it's like silicon. There's no difference. It may be even slightly better than silicon. So this is a big excitement. Now, what's the structure of this new dye? We don't know. The Japanese keep it as a secret for the time being. But I will go to Japan next week. Maybe they will tell me. So I know, of course, these are friends, but of course, they have their commercial interests also. But you know approximately what they, it's close to our dye structure, the one of the green dye. So it took a while. Today, we are here, 2010, first paper published, the first cell of this time in 1991, and so. 19 years, now you've got a system that has a very broad panchromatic light harvesting and generates electric charges over this whole spectral range with over 90% efficiency. It's a remarkable progress, but it wasn't made by one group. It's years of frustrations, of course. Research is not always rewarding. You have to have a lot of persistency and patience. So never give up. Here comes that new dye, and we'll soon know what it is. Let me also tell you, we came up with a green dye. So that's an invention that was described in Angewandte Chemie recently. And this porphyrin, this looks similar to the porphyrin that is used in the green, by the green plants. The structure is very similar, except putting a donor here and an acceptor on the other side. Actually, I should say that this was not our invention. I should be very modest. This invention was made in Taiwan. And the group that first came up with that suggestion is the group of Eric Diao and Professor Yi. Let me just see whether I find their names. Yeah, of Diao and Yi, these two. So I cite their paper. But they didn't get a very good conversion efficiency when they tested this. They don't have the experience to make solar cells. We're making solar cells since 20 years. So we came up with 11% cell, first one. And see the nice green color, and so soon after the first green leaf was made, using the dye and producing electric power from sunlight, and that was done in Japan by Toyota Iseki. And so now let me finish, because it's getting late, so let me just tell you where we are today with some of the commercial applications and upscaling of that cell. So our strong point with regards to competition, there are many solar cells out there. It's very competitive. And believe me, now it's getting much more competitive. In the 90s, nobody walked around. Only six silicon. We had entered the field. Everybody was suspicious about disensitized. It's a very hard time to occupy some small territory. So, but today, I mean, this is crazy. There's every day there's a new solar cell advantage. But here are our cards, strong cards. The color, and the architects getting very excited about it. So we were, for example, we were contacted by Roland Garros, the stadium in France, the tennis championship. They want to make a glass kind of covered, or the wall, glass wall stadium. They want to change the stadium into something that used disensitized cells to produce the electric power for the lighting of the courts. So it's getting more and more in now in an application where people realize where the strengths of technologies. That's our strength. We can make colored windows producing glass. Nobody else can look through colored windows producing electric power. So this is, you see some examples. We also have, for example, Sony is making those lamps. You can see the artistic flavor. These lamps are photovoltaic cells. Every one of those panels is a disensitized solar cell. So what Sony does is they just structure it. They have a designer that turns the whole thing can be screen printed, so you make some motifs and beautiful. Beautiful structures. And when the German president came a couple of weeks ago with our president, Sony wanted to be there. They said, we can come and show the two presidents our labs. You want us to come? I said, sure, why not? I mean, it's nice. So of course, they were amazed because these lamps are autark. Need no power supply. They take the ambient light, convert ambient light into electric power. The cells capture light from all angles, from the back, from the front. So even in light like this, you will charge up the battery, and in the evening, the light is produced by a LED, light-emitting diode. This is a Walkman being charged. So the first disensitized sunglasses in Korea. Very good stability results. Yeah, I should mention to you, this is not, I mentioned to you the ionic liquids. That's an idea I had like 16 years ago. I thought, well, the battery people use ionic, they have really molten salts in the battery. You have molten salts very often in some of the battery, not the lithium ion technology, but some of the primary batteries. And I use bromide, bromine, molten salt, and that inspired me to use the same concept of ionic liquids in solar cells. Now this has become a commercial commodity, and Merck is selling. So big companies entering the field now, striving to become commercial suppliers of chemicals or components. It's a good sign. Facades being now equipped with the Dyson-sized Dreamhouse. As I mentioned to you already, here is the visitor. You see, this is Doris Leuthard and Christian Wolff. I don't know whether you recognize him, but this is Christian Wolff. And here is a computer, a keyboard for PC, and you see we had, these are the solar cells, flexible solar cells, Dyson cells, powering this keyboard. First in diffuse light, and this, you can see the black, red, and gold. This is a German flag, so one, G24 had made one in the Swiss and one in Germany. And it impressed the two persons. So it's very important the politicians know things are moving and there's reasons to be generous to the scientific community, which produces new concepts, new ideas. And also, of course, the young people, we have a training. We give classes to kids and also the gymnasium, the people from high school, the students. We show them how to make a solar cell. And using natural dyes, it's the anthocyanin dyes. Here we had used some blackberries. Or the best is actually use red cabbage. The dye is very, very good, very stable. And or hibiscus tea. So these dyes go on surface. They become charge-generating sensitizers. And these kids can make their own cells. You see how infatuated these young people are. And we need to do an education. It's not enough if a few people know about this and understand the technology. So here's a dye-sensitized module at Tsinghua, which I visited this summer. So the students had built that module. It's already a challenge, I mean, to make a module like that. And I should also mention to you that the Chinese have set up a center in Wuhan in my name. So it's a great honor for me. And I'm delighted that things are spreading and the technology is growing. And so we had a big opening event, and they already had built those panels powering a display that you can see that's behind, which had a welcome address, showed a welcome address. So they already, in a very short time, had come up with those panels. That was amazing. So with that, I'm through. I think I should stop here. It's almost 9 o'clock, so I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Gretz, for this nice lecture, and we'll take some questions now from the audience. Yes, please.
Thank you very much for your lecture and your visit. I would like to ask you the following. We have these great dyes today that convert the high amount of photons into electrons, and we have this great charge separation, conductivity in the system, but still the efficiency is low compared to the numbers of separate components. So where is this energy loss? Where is the bottleneck?
Yes, there is a loss in the present system, which is just a mismatch problem. I can show it to you easily. The triiodide is a nice mundane type, cheap. It has all the good properties, except for one property, which I'll point out to you. Yeah, it's this slide, actually. I will show you. It's drawn. This slide is drawn to scale for the iodide triiodide and shows you the loss. You're right. The efficiency today is 12%. 12%. What's the maximum efficiency? Well, theoretical maximum for a single junction is 31%. So, well, of course, you cannot reach 31, there's always losses. But say, why aren't we at 25, for example? And so the main reason is this mismatch here. We have the dye is injecting, as you said, everything works fine there, and the recombination is slow, and so we have good charge separation. We can collect the light absorption. Until recently, we were actually not absorbing up to 900. Okay, so there was a first loss in the lack of near-infrared sensitivity. But it seems the Japanese have now a new dye. But I don't know what the dye is. So let's just say that was, until very recently, a problem. The first loss was an insufficient harvesting of near-infrared photons. But this wasn't the main loss. The main loss was actually here, the regeneration step. This is drawn to scale. Our sensitizer is about, I don't know whether you guys are electrochemists, but it's 1 volt against normal hydrogen. That's the potential of oxidation of sensitizer on the film. So that's fine, but we know our iodide is at 0.4. So what that means is almost half of the photon energy is lost in the regeneration step. So this step where we regenerate the dye by the redox mediator, moving the positive charge from the film surface to the counter electrode, we have to put a shuttle in. And that shuttle is just not well matched. Well, of course, we all knew that for a long time, so why didn't we replace that shuttle? Well, we tried, of course. Lots of other people tried. And so only recently has there been a breakthrough with some new mediators that reach higher voltage. As a consequence of this mismatch, you have a limitation on your voltage, because the voltage is actually the difference between this level here, the so-called Fermi level of the electrons in the TiO2, which is a dashed line. Depending on how intense the light is, it will move up, but let's just say it's close to conduction band. And your redox system. So if you lose 600 millivolts, well, you lose it on this level. You could get, suppose you would lose only 300. Well, then you're at 15% or 16%. So there's a huge gain to be made. And fortunately, this whole thing is unraveling at the moment. We have ourselves been able to make much higher voltage cells, like over 900 millivolts, while these cells have usually 700. So this is addressed. Unfortunately, there is now a kind of a breakthrough in the redox mediators, or Hall conductors, they're called. But the answer to the question is, there are two problems. One is lack of near-infrared light response, and this loss is way too big. Although I have to tell you something, in silicon, you also lose half of your voltage. Half of the photon energy is lost. You get, when you look at the voltage of a silicon photovoltaic cell, it's about 600 millivolts, maybe 700, but not more. But the photon energy is 1.2 volts, so it's also a loss by recombination. Despite of that, you can make a cell that is 24%. Why? How come? Well, it's the current is collecting a huge amount of current because it's responding up to 1,000 nanometers. So,
thank you.
Long answer, simple question.
Thank you very much for an inspiring lecture. I have a question related also to the electrolytes. Actually, there has been a lot of investigations in the field of solid-state electrolytes. Can you comment on this? Where are we going, or is there a potential? It seems to me that the record efficiency cells have all the liquid electrolyte, but actually for long-lasting periods and expecting long lifetime, we need solid-state electrolyte.
Yes, it's true. Yes, this is absolutely correct what you're saying. And so, if I may go back, I skipped over one slide pretty quickly. These are now industrial cells, and you see that these are non-volatile ionic liquid electrolytes. Actually, they are so-called nanocomposites. The ionic liquid is made into solid by addition of oxide particles, like silicon oxide nanoparticles. And so why does it work so well? It seems that the addition of those nanoparticles actually enhances the efficiency. You would think it should not. It should actually be more problematic to transport charges if you have a composite. But that's not the case. And the reason for that is that in the iodide, triiodide electrolyte, you have the so-called co-tooth mechanism. So the charge can move like protons in water without displacing really the ions, just by bond flipping. So the module efficiency here is 8 to 9% module efficiency, stable. That's not bad for a solid electrolyte. Well, we are not at 12%, but Sony has announced 9.5% module efficiency. So the loss is not that bad. It's just that it's true when you go from the liquids to these more viscous systems, it's a challenge. And you have to work with the ones that we have published in Nature Materials. We have published on eutectic melts. That's where you start. For good reasons, these eutectic melts of ionic liquids are better than just the pure ionic liquid. It took a while for us and for others to understand why. And so it's sophisticated. The electrolyte question is very sophisticated, because you don't want to have a solvent that is unstable. You want something that's non-toxic. And so there's a lot of room for work on the electrolytes, solid electrolytes. Some we are also working on electronic cold conductors. But the efficiencies of these cells are 6.5% today. So they cannot compete with the ionic liquid at the moment.
Yes.
There's also a counter electrode in this cell. Is there some kinetic limitation on this side?
It's an issue let me flip that slide up one more time. It's an issue for those flexible cells, the rucksacks. Who asked me the question? The rucksacks I showed you, these are flexible cells where you come in through the counter electrode. And so and then you really are limited to a transparent collector, okay? And so you might say, why don't you go through the working electrode? Well, it's not all that easy, because you have to sinter those titanium particles on a plastic. Then there is an issue with the sintering. But it will not be very long. You will hear about a tremendous breakthrough that has been achieved in Sweden that will deal with that issue of avoiding the coming in through the counter electrode. But for the moment, that's what we have. And there it's really an issue, because we need to have a transparent conductor, and we need a catalyst that helps with the triiodide, iodide. And at the moment, this catalyst is platinum. It's very little. It's not really a cost issue. That's only 50 milligrams on a square meter. But this platinum is absorbing light, cutting the... It needs some primer. There's some titanium first they have put in platinum. And the cost, this adds the cost. Not because the platinum is a lot and costs expense, but just the process, this indium tin oxide, and there's... So this thing has to be removed. It will. I think the moment is now very close. This is really a stumbling block for the flexible cells, where you have the light coming is through the counter electrode. Otherwise, here the you can use carbon, and there are lots of cobalt sulfide, there are lots of catalysts you can use on this side if you don't have a condition of transparency, especially when you use plastics, because if you had a glass, then that's easy to make a very thin platinum layer on glass that will stick. You can heat it up. We have even patent on this. That's not an issue, but if it becomes a plastic, there is a problem. So it's been addressed, but it's a major cost issue now.
Any more questions? Well, if not, let's thank the speaker again.